Welcome back to DreamHack Winter Grand Prix. This is the best of 16 after 9 rounds of Swiss with me, RDU, and Raven, my co-caster for the whole day. And RDU just finished actually top 16, which is kind of, you know, unfortunate, but at least you can cast now, so that's something, right?
Yeah, it's always good to like watch some Hearthstone games and see others lose, not only you.
Okay, I mean, you played really well. All casters were like kind of astounded how the game went. Being one of lethal is something, you know, I'm a meme in our game. So it's something that will be remembered for a long time. And right now we'll be having a match between Bors and Zetalot. We had Bors already once on stream. He's a German player who has a massive background in other card games like World of Warcraft, like Lord of the Rings, which he was a national champion in. So he's not a newcomer to competitive gaming, but he's kind of new to a competitive Hearthstone scene. He was playing some ESL Pro League, if I'm not mistaken,
yeah,
right?
the German league,
division.
Yeah.
And he was twice in the finals there, but this is his first international event.
Yeah, because he said he took a huge break, right? He said he played from like the first week of beta when it first came out, and then just took a small 18-month break
break.
Then come back and I'll just play in DreamHack, okay?
When the game is like 2 years old.
Yeah, that's a reasonable break considering the amount of time it's been out, yeah.
And on the other side, we have Zetalot, who is the Polish streamer, but he's streaming in English, and part also of SK Gaming. He's the most known player in that group, and let's sum up Zetalot in one word: priest.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah, definitely.
Class.
And he's been performing really well with it. From what I've heard about some of the matches, I've not caught up on all of his scores and what class he used to get them all, but I know he's 3-0'd a couple of his rounds with his priest. So.
Which is awesome, right? Because it's a control priest. It's not a dragon.
Yeah, it's control priest, yeah.
It's not a dragon priest. It's not a other variants, just a standard control, old control style priest, which is kind of fun to watch. Sometimes underwhelming because... you know, the cards have value only when comboing with each other. So there's a huge value put on cards like Cleric, an example.
Yeah. I think something that we were talking about in terms of in the preparation for the tournament, actually, was that... who were we talking to? I can't remember now. But saying that when they're prepping for the tournament, you can't make a lineup that counters a lot of decks or all the decks. And then they said because people just thought, oh, a lot of people aren't going to bring Priest, then they held off, and then that's how Zetalot's been performing so well with his Priest as well, because I know from a couple of the players that lost to him, they just said, well, Priest does really well against my lineup, but I wasn't planning on running into it, because in a Swiss format, you're going to play a lot of matches, right? So.
Mm-hmm. Okay, but here we go with the first game between Bors and Zetalot. This is top 16 of Hearthstone Grand Prix here at DreamHack Winter, and Bors is picking up the Tempo Mage against Druid, mid-range one. So, how do you judge this matchup?
I played versus Bors, and his Tempo Mage is really, really greedy. He runs double Ethereal Conjunctor, I think.
The new card, the 6-3.
And he also runs other Drake or Drakes. So he's
That's interesting.
His deck is like super greedy.
All the 5 drops.
This is basically... fills both of those cards are filling the same spot, the same purpose, right?
Kind of the same mana cost.
Yeah, they're both 5 drops, aren't they? And like a lot of the time in Tempo Mage, although they have the cards later on, it's very focused on the early game with getting the Flame Wakers out and then comboing low cost spells to create the board advantage.
Oh my god, double mirror image.
That's the best driving because you can like play twice and then trade. But you choose to go for another play.
Mana Addict, okay.
It is interesting because we saw Bors playing some unorthodox decisions with his Druid, if I remember correctly, when he was playing last round of Swiss against... Who was that?
Oh God, it was against...
Born to Win?
Yes, Born to Win. And he was holding off to his... to his innervates for a very long time, to the point where they were almost useless. And in this situation here, he is holding off to double mirror images, who has the best. They have the best value used early game, especially against Druid, who has
The main thing in this situation as well, it's because he had the mana worm down. He could have played them both, and like Ida, you said, he could have just traded and got rid of that straight away. And there goes the a bit of the ramp from the Druid early on.
And now he will have kind of a hard time dealing with this creature because he will lose tempo. And so his option is either Arcane Intellect and give the initiative back to Druid, who has very low amount of free drops usually. So he can risk that. But we know that Zetod is holding back on the, with his Shadow of Nexramas in his hand.
And a pretty good draw from the Arcane Intellect. Do you know if he's playing Mirror Entity?
Yeah, I Secret. Think he plays twice.
Okay, because that's something that's actually pretty yeah, important yeah. in this matchup, at least. Because if you just look now at Zetalot's hand, any of those cards getting Mirror Entity, obviously the Keeper of the Grove is like the best one for Zetalot. Mm-hmm. But it's still a 2/4, right? It's still going to stick around.
Well, he might have also the second down as Aspirant and keep it for that special occasion.
So
Flamemaker is really good here because you set up a really good board, you have a 25% chance to kill the Shade, and afterwards you can follow up with more spells or with Loteb, which usually steals a turn. But I don't think you want to steal turn 5 from the Druid. Loteb is like way better later.
Oh, he just got one to face and one to... But the thing is, the Flamewake is fairly safe, unless it's a swipe. Oh. Wow, okay. I wish I could do that for my own games.
I don't think you can swipe this board anyway. You have to develop your minions.
I mean, he didn't have any other play. I mean, what would you play? Mad Scientist and make 4 images?
Yeah, that's true. The only thing is, like, would you not swipe here then? I just think that if you don't swipe and leave Flamewaker, then, like, Frostbolt just ruins you.
I think you have to swipe.
Silence doesn't really do much.
He wants to be really greedy with the swipe, but I'm not sure what do you want to kill.
Yeah, what are you actually waiting for in Tempo Mage to get like a better swipe off than like the Flamewaker? That's the word I was looking for.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Maybe he wants to go like Emperor turn 6 and then turn 7 Azadrake swipe. That's the only thing
that's
I can
true,
see.
Yeah.
Probably, yeah. I don't mind this line. I think he goes for the later gameplay plan.
It's kind of weird because he is leaving out his Shadow Nexramas to the attack from the Flamenco, which set up a good swipe, but that swipe would have to happen on turn 5.
Yeah.
Right? So, it's kind of weird. Ooh, 0 mana Rough Guard. Well, it's a huge minion, so it's not that bad, right?
Yeah, and at the moment, at least, like, the Tempo Mage isn't bothered about their own health, so...
Oh,
is that a DC?
No idea.
No. I know what happened. He expected the Flamemaker to get some hits, but his Flamemaker is silenced.
Yeah, I'm just thinking because he's pulled the headset down.
His Flamemaker is silenced.
Yeah, but he's roping.
Nothing wrong here.
I think he's DC'd.
No, I don't think he's DC'd.
He must be. Because he can't just... He's not just stopping the game because his Flamemaker is silenced.
Yeah,
right?
Of course not.
I know.
That would be really, really weird.
He's like, guys, stop. Why is my Flamemaker silenced? This shouldn't be allowed.
Oh, hi, back. hey, guys. So, admins will figure out what's going on because we're not exactly sure. I mean, I had the same impression as RDU that he just forgot.
The initial reaction looked like he was like, oh, crap. You know, where's my extra damage?
Yeah, but I guess that's not a valid reason to stop the game.
Yeah,
and
like,
just not
what?
Make his turn when he have actual, like, Mad Scientist and the Rev Guard, because that's actually a great setup against every single druid. You put... Two bodies on board, which druid has problems to deal with, and we'll see how.
And also the Mad Scientist being down, like he saw Keeper of the Grove, so he couldn't silence the scientist, and everything else in his hand were pretty like chunky minions.
Mm-hmm.
So as you said, if it's got double mirror entity, if he kills the scientist, then it's like, what can I actually play? Because this is worse than ignoring the scientist at this point.
Yeah, I think it was looking really good for both in this situation, but. No, we'll never know.
Yeah, it really feels bad. Usually, tournaments accord death wins, but here, because they provide a tournament, we probably will have a regame, I think.
Yeah, I think that's been what they've done for the previous matches, if there's been any DCs. As long as there's not lethal on the board, is my understanding. As long as it's not like actual lethal, they regame, as far as I'm aware. Mm-hmm. But we'll obviously wait for confirmation on that one.
Of course. I mean, we'll have a confirmation from admins in just a few seconds, I assume. All right. Yeah. In the meantime, what we can do? I can't even remember what was the lineup from Boss. He had a mage, he had a warrior, and a druid, I guess, right?
It was paladin, mage, druid. And Zetalot has priest. And
the first class. Zetalot has priest. That's all we need to know. The other two decks he just concedes with, and then just goes right priest.
Oh right, he has the the tempo mage, right? That was
the tempo mage because he caught off guard
One of the players before, because he put Zetalot on a control mage, I mean on a freeze mage, and it was actually turns out it was a tempo mage.
Oh, okay, I didn't know that.
Wait, see?
The conjurer. Yeah.
Conjurer, interesting.
It's a really weird card. It's like super glass cannon, but can provide you with great things. Like versus me, I had, I think, a full board. He played Conjurer, and next turn he Flame Strikes.
Oh, wow. Yeah. Because like mage has got the best spells in the game, right?
Yeah.
Does he? So I feel like Hunter has great spells too.
If you look at all of the Hunter spells and all of the Mage spells, mm-hmm. all of the Mage spells on average are better than the Hunter ones, right?
Yeah, I mean, okay, I'm looking from perspective, which card gives you spells from Hunters, and it's only in Scarab, right? Because that gives you 3 mana spells. So it's like Kill Command, Unleash the Hounds, Deadly Shot, those kind of things, right?
Yeah. I'm just thinking Frostbolt, Fireball, Torch. All the secrets.
Actually,
like
Torch is very interesting if you get it from Conjurer.
Yeah, exactly. Like I said, I think that in Mage, it's played because of the Mage spells of good. The mm-hmm, body itself, mm-hmm. like you said, is very susceptible to low damage. But we are back in the game, and it does look like there's a regame. And again, a pretty reasonable start from Boz, actually. He's got the Mana Worm out and actually buffed it up to 3 with that Arcane Intellect and Coin. And goes straight into the Mad Scientist. And again, the Mad Scientist is going to be a problem because he does have to kill it eventually, or Mad Scientist will just run into something anyway. And then he has to try and navigate the Mirror Entity. And again, I imagine by now that Zetalot and pretty much all the players will know almost card for card what their opponents are playing.
I think it was really important to hit that 12.5% Arcane missiles because now he can like curve out perfectly. And otherwise, you'd have to like coin the ping instead of the scientist, which is like not exactly the best thing ever.
Yeah,
you know what's funny? This is actually playable.
Yeah.
Right,
how convenient.
Yeah.
Now, Manoi cannot even get swiped.
Yeah, exactly. Swipe's insane. Like, swipe would have been good, but.
I don't think it would be that good. Probably still play Shredder there. Now, you might play Keeper? Let me see.
Probably have 2 options, right? You trade with the Mana Worm and play Keeper and kill silence the Mad Scientist.
Yeah.
Or you just play Pelted Shredder, but it's probably better to kill the Mad Scientist afterwards or silence it with trade. A few options. For 10-6, you can actually use Force of Nature to get some trades with the Tempo Mage.
Yeah. What do you guys actually like here? Because nothing's like too easy to stack up. If you want to run the Scientist in, to get the Mirror Entity for turn 5 to maybe stop a Druid of the Claw being played. But it looks like he's just going with Shredder, which I actually like. And this isn't bad Shredder placement, guys. just before Twitch chat get involved, like this is actual Shredder placement based on the Spellstopper, of course.
But it can still be targeted by Keeper if he wants to silence that. So that's not a problem. But he goes, of course, for the Mad Scientist, which grants his opponent a better value. Just looking from the mirror entities. Oh,
he's just gonna play it instead. Maybe this is really interesting actually because the druid's on 17 health. There's like 6 on board, and he has burn in his hand. The fireball is actually pretty important now.
Mm-hmm. So you think you would rather go for a mad scientist into unstable portal or first unstable portal to see what are you getting and just go in face with everything you have?
Yeah, I mean I wouldn't. It's tough. Like you kind of want the mad scientist down, but I wouldn't even mind too much unstable portal with the mirror entity.
I think you want 100% ping scientist because you want the second entity out of your deck. You don't want to be able to have any remote chance to draw it.
Mm-hmm.
It's I just think it's a misplay because
it's just because you've seen one Keeper of the Grove and one Shade. Like, what can you drop now? That's like, I mean, there's the aspirant, I guess, that would be a bad drop for mirror entity. But other than that, there's not a lot you can really play.
He already played one aspirant and. The chance of him having a second one is like super small, and he would have played it probably last turn or something like that.
And that's why I like the mirror entity. It sort of just blocks out the druid a little bit until
he can. Oh, look at that! The amount of healing in this board is way too high.
Yeah, and we've seen a lot of these totems in the past day or so.
A lot of another burn card for boss. Well, this is a turn one. Just drop unstable portal first.
Yeah.
Then you ping the light well and play scientist.
It depends. Yeah. What kind of creature do you get from the unstable portal?
Well, I think you definitely ping Lightwell, so it has a chance to heal itself.
You might not play Scientist this turn because you want to get maximum value out of the secret, and if it gets roughed or something, you will not.
Colisson Manager. So ping first, then play Mad Scientist, and then play Colisson Manager.
Yeah, Colisson comes back to the hand, I think, if you Inspire.
Yes.
So he has like a negative effect for the Inspire.
But well, it's not exactly negative because it practically acts like a, let's say, heal for free mana.
Yeah, the problem is when it comes back to his hand, it won't cost zero mana anymore.
And yes, that's true. Oh, misplay.
Oh. Wait.
Oh, yeah, I think he just realized. We just saw a bit of a action from Bolt to go.
And
oh,
that
yes,
did cost
that
him
minion.
Three, possible three damage.
Yeah, that's actually huge because double fireball is so much burn, but if your opponent's healing for plus three, it becomes really difficult to deal with.
Obviously, he doesn't play enough arenas.
Yeah,
to know the interactions.
Definitely. I mean, you can just read the card. You don't need to play arena.
Yeah, you can actually just read the card before you play it. That's also a trick that people know about.
It's not a shame, like... yeah. everybody did it, probably.
Yeah, everyone's done it once. He probably won't do that again if he ever sees that card in a deck.
That will cost him the game, definitely not. He will remember that for the rest of his life.
Do you play Flamewaker and just clear the 0/5 now with a fireball, or do you think that's using?
No.
Are you just okay with the three heal?
I think just fireball face here, hit for one, with the random damage from.
Because fireball's only doing three damage, though. That's the problem.
Why three? No, you can hit the Lightwell with the random damage from the Flamewaker.
I like fireballing, but I would have fireball phase for sure.
Yeah, gone for the pings. Yeah, that's true.
Because the ping makes it at 50-50 to heal.
And also with the pings, like the Lightwell's only healing for one off the fireball.
Yes, exactly.
Right. Yeah, that's right.
And Lightwell is not a huge threat anyways, so you don't need to waste damage on it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's true. Mm-hmm.
This is some questionable plays. Maybe it's like the tension and stuff. Like I remember myself, I was super tension at 2-2, but I think it was like a different set.
Well, you know, Boss is new to the international competitive scene, so I can see that having an effect on him.
I like this line from Zed a lot. You give him something and then you kill it.
Yeah,
it's pretty efficient.
And he gets rid of the Flamewaker too.
Now you can get maximum value from the manager. You just trade, ping.
Super back to the office.
Super good, right? You still play the Shredder.
Yeah, you always just still play the Shredder, right? He's got Shredder. You just put it down. You don't need Fireball yet. It's fine. Okay. Is he going to ping?
I don't think he'll actually ping yet.
Was he going to
ping
his own?
Ping manager.
That doesn't work. Does that work?
No, it doesn't. His fire activates afterwards.
Okay. I would have tried it. I would have been like, I'm going to look really cool now. Ping. Oh, awkward. Okay. So, is your right, I guess, just to get the 2/5 drops down? Right?
Mm-hmm. Definitely. Like the Drill to the Claw in time mode is huge obstacle.
Oh, that's a really good draw because it plays on curve.
Just draw another fireball. Or a pyroblast, it'll be fine.
We play Conjurer first.
Yeah, of course. For two reasons. The first reason is the Discover, and the second one is the Shredder. You don't want to get mana off.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
I mean.
Okay.
Okay. I mean, it works in the same way of like you would always draw first, right? Because you kind of want to see what you got, because it could impact your turn.
Yeah, yeah. Like he would get Arcane Intellect and maybe want to play it. I don't know.
Oh, does he want duplicate to then use more? discover more cards.
To have Vitality Totem twice in his hand?
Oh, yeah. He's
amazing.
Never die. And then ping him down to win, because he's healing for too much every turn.
Seems like the Conjurer might be doing work if there will be no Wrath here. And there's no Wrath.
The Conjurer has a really greedy HP. It's like super... hard to like hit free sometimes, but sometimes it's like super easy.
Yeah, it's a similar way to the way True Heart works, right? Because sometimes True Heart just gets like destroyed easy, but sometimes it actually like the attack on it just kills pretty much most minions in the game.
I guess you draw first.
Mana Worm and Frostbolt, and that's 6, 9, 12, 13. That's enough damage to finish off the game.
So the Ethereal actually won him that game, or won him that game this quickly, should I say?
Let's say that an Azure Drake would have done the same. Because he would
have... Frostbolt the...
I mean, he had such a huge board advantage and he would get the Dr. Boom next turn.
Yeah, I mean, he wasn't close to lethal, I wasn't saying that. You know, he wasn't close to actually getting killed himself. But I mean, the favoured matchup there, I think Temple Mage does pretty well versus Druid. And we saw the power of... Mirror Entity there. You got the Mirror Entity down, and he just went, right, okay, well, you kind of need to play around this because he had nothing at all. It's really difficult for Druid. he eventually got it with the big game hunter, like you said, and the clay, which is nice, but it just came far too late.
Okay, so now let's think. What type of matchup would Vizetta choose? Would he go for the control priest? It's kind of controversial, right? Because it should be good against aggro, but at the same time, I'm not sure how it fares against a tempo mage.
So it should. I mean, I don't know tons about what his control priest looks like, but it should be pretty okay. I mean, we can see a mind control. I did know about that actually. Oh, Death Lord's pretty nice.
I think that you go priest for sure. Because, okay, let's say you go tempo mage. If you go tempo mage, even if you win the mirror match, which is like 50-50 at best, then he goes paladin, and then you probably lose. You
have because to go priest. It's paladin, right?
You have to go priest, and you'll get the priest into druid anyways. Well, if you go priest now, you probably win this, and then he'll go druid, and then you have tempo mage versus druid. Mm-hmm. So you have like better chances overall. Yep.
Very good insight, RDU. I can see why you were top 16.
Yeah, single elimination, unfortunately. Ended my streak at just top 16.
Next time, man. Next time. Yeah. So, you can just start with the mirror image right now if you want to be on curve on turn 3.
I like holding on to it because you have the Flame Waker. Because, I mean, what's the priest going to drop that you really need the mirror image for at this point?
I don't like holding it because you want to play Flame Waker and then play the two mana cost cards, right? You want a curve.
Oh, yeah, exactly. He has Frostbolt Paul.
That was my point.
But then, like, would you want to just ping this turn?
Now, that's very interesting.
This is sketchy.
Yeah, I'm always a fan of playing on curve, especially when you're playing the aggressive deck, who has a huge advantage over control decks that can just punish bad draws.
Like, now, don't you want to play mirror image so I have the powerful minion next turn? Yeah,
to stay on curve and be defensive when it comes to your minions, right?
I like that he read the card this time.
It has no text.
Doesn't matter.
He made sure, though. He checked. He went over it twice.
Okay, so now there's few options, and seems like the biggest minion is the best.
Yeah.
But imagine if you would actually buff the creature last turn. And first turn 2 mirror image, turn 3 Flamewaker into Frostbolt ping would have been perfect to kill the Deathlord and still have another minion on board.
Yeah, that kind of hurts.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's really bad. At first I said, oh, well, the Shadow of Death in hand, you know, like, fine, you can 69. Just kill it. But then I was like, okay, you can just forge in.
No, never mind.
No, I got it, love that. I got it. Just not going to go too in-depth about that joke, that's all.
So there you go, Conjurer or Azure Drake? I feel it's like Conjurer this time because Priest has a problem to deal with damage, right?
I have no idea. Like, his plays are really hard to predict. I have done like so many different things.
Yeah, you're already at the point where it's like, well, this game would have looked very differently if I played it.
Yeah.
He goes for the Frostbolt on...
I like this, yeah.
On the Volgen, of course. Okay. He has the board advantage still. Oh.
Is it? Surely it's not worth when you're playing into Holy Nova turn, right?
Not into 10-5, yes.
Two damage just isn't worth it. It's not as if the Mana Worm's going to survive either to like get the buff.
He really likes the mirror image for some reason. Probably he has Antonitis or something and he wants to like get some value from that, but I don't find like other reasons for why would you keep it so much time in your hand.
Yeah, I understand this turn because of Holy Nova. But earlier on, I think he could have got away with it a bit easier.
That's a really good turn. Clean board, still have two minions on board, and your opponent has a huge problem to deal with the Arcanine, because you want to ping it, but at the same time, you have only 5 drops.
Do you just conjure it into Arcane Missiles? Is that the plan?
But I mean,
I suppose, actually, if he plays Arcane Missiles, draws it, he can clear the board. Well, it's a bit of a play, but and as we see, Drew Scientist, so maybe not quite as good.
You have to go for the mirror image this turn.
He'll probably never play it, I don't know.
Amazing, then.
His deck is also really built in a super greedy way with like double Azidrake and double Conjurer, as we see. And
as well as Lothab, so there's so well many 5 drops.
Yeah, like his plan is to just get some early game and then survive until turn 5 and then win,
yeah,
I guess. But it's not always that way.
Yeah, but even the Light of the Narrow, which is actually just at the moment 3 damage and summon the creature. Whoa! For a second, Zetlock aimed at himself, but then I realized this guy kind of knows what he's doing with Priest, so he wouldn't quite make that mistake.
I think it's just like a spectator dog.
Oh, when he like starts to use the spell. Yeah. Oh, okay.
So like unless he does it in the other way, like just ignoring his face, usually it, this box appears.
Okay, so what do you actually like here? Because nothing feels great. You can ping up. The problem is if he pings off the 3-1, it just means he can heal Vol'jin.
You can go Azadrake, draw missiles, and kill Vol'jin and Okenai.
Yeah, he should just do that then, right?
It's like that.
Oh. Got the first word right, but not the second. It was Arcane Intellect. He does go for the ping, which is, you know, it is fine. It's not fantastic, but he needs to, you know, do something. He's still on full health, but I just can't see this Vol'jin dying for quite a while. And he even has Sylvanas, Shadow Word, Death, if he needs to steal the Archmage Antonidas anytime soon.
I don't think he plays Antonidas in this deck. Like, playing Antonidas and that many 5-drops is, like, pretty suicidal.
Yeah, but that's what the Conjurers are for, to give him so many more spells for Antonidas, right?
I mean, he usually played with spare parts Antonidas, and he has, like, no spare part gain in his deck, so...
What are we talking about? No Antonidas? He has two in his deck. The two unstable portals.
Oh, yeah, just portal into it. That's how
it
works.
Easy.
Right? Yeah. Every time.
Okay, so the ping's happening on Vol'jin. There's no way it's not, right?
Definitely. So ping into low tip? No, that dies to his hero power from the Light Warden.
Yeah.
You can play Mirror Image. But he's afraid to do so.
Yeah.
So he goes for the low tip, so I wouldn't be surprised if he goes for the Mirror Image this turn.
Yeah, it's good because you protect it against AoE, right?
You cannot even get Holy Novot.
Yeah, exactly, yeah.
Probably the best turn to use it. I mean, not early game was the best turn to
use
it. Because you cannot get Holy Novot.
But that's his second mirror image, though, isn't it?
Yes, that's
he's
the second
two
one.
Now.
Yeah.
So he still has a huge threat on board, which is the
Light
Warden.
There's so many cards that haven't changed in Control Priest for so long. Like, it's still running the Alcanat Egg combo and the Blade Master. I wonder if those cards are ever actually going to get cycled out.
I mean, unless we get better vanilla cards, probably not.
Yeah.
Or Priest getting some better cards.
Which we don't really want to see. Or at least I don't. I hate Priest.
I know that everybody wants to see like the worst classes being better, but people just forget about like Shaman being super OP and all the games relying on Lightning Storm hitting high. And I don't think I want to see that, for example. Like, everybody loves Shaman on Reddit and stuff, but I don't know. I just don't want to see Lightning Storms deciding games.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a little
okay,
bit
I can see that. I mean, Lightning Storm for now is still a staple in Shamans. Unless it's, of course, an aggressive Shaman, but if you want to play something else than an aggressive Shaman, then yeah, then you need Lightning Storms.
Oh!
Oh, wow.
Oh, that was pretty good.
I think it was correct to trade before, but if you get that lucky, you can play it however you want. And, like, it doesn't matter. Like, yeah.
If you get that RNG, you can do these plays.
Zetalot was visibly upset about that outcome. I mean, no wonder, right? Light Warden was the biggest threat on the board.
One out of 16. Easy.
Is he going to... Oh, okay.
What? Zombie Chow?
Yeah, steal the Zombie Chow back and just... he has Alcanai, right? That's 10 damage. The burst is real.
It still looks good for Zetalot. He's at full health, has the board advantage, and...
has Light Bomb, has Sylvanas, has Death.
Yeah, there's a lot of stuff.
And this is what this Priest deck does, right? It just sort of just grinds the game to a halt, and then every Priest play, even though it requires a lot of combinations, a lot of the cards actually work with more than just one combo as well. So you just grind the game out.
Unstable Portal and get Deathwing, I don't know. Even that is not good enough. I really don't see a way for the mage to win versus Priest. It's like such a one-sided matchup. And Zetalot plays his Priest really, really well.
Yeah. I mean, how much does Flame Strike off the Conjure help?
I mean, he cannot play it.
No, yeah, not for this turn, but...
Unless you also get an Innervate somehow.
Wow, he loves
if he just
image.
Has any cards he wants, then, you know, maybe he can win this, but...
He actually went for the Mirror Image. Look at that.
He loves the card. He just wants it in his hand at all times.
Trades low tip into a good target. The Cabal Shadow Priest goes down, and Mirror Image protects the minions in fury, because there is a lot of combinations that can turn the board around.
Does Zetalot care enough about having that Flame Waker to not light? Well, it can just heal Light Bomb, right?
Yep.
This is fine. I mean, it leaves the 0-2s up, but you can kill the 0-2s with the Zombie Chow and the Flame Waker anyway.
You probably can play the Cleric first, like draw one more card, because you don't really care if the Cleric is 1-3 or 1-2.
Yeah.
But you will have Zombie Chow that can be healed, right?
You heal your Flame Waker.
Yeah.
Oh, I mean,
so just die from Light Bomb.
Okay,
that's all.
Seems that he wants to go for another line. I'm fine with that.
It's okay because it can kill them at scientists. Eh. Wow.
Pretty good.
Yeah, that was kind of amazing.
This works as well. They could just give him another zombie chat.
The mirror entities have a lot of value. It's a reversed mind blast for his opponent.
And we see like the difference in power of mirror entity against certain classes specifically. So the opposite was what happened in the Druid. It was super strong, pretty much locking the Druid out from playing a lot of his minions. Whereas in Priest, because they play so many low drops and have so many weird ways to deal with them anyway, a lot of answers, that he just doesn't really care at this point. And this board's so strong, and there's still an AoE clear. There's still a Sylvanas. There's Alcanite. Even the Blademaster to actually start to put on pressure next turn. At least the mage can heal.
How good of a strategy do you think it is for Boris to just concede here and not get himself more fatigued for no reason while he has like probably 0% chance to win?
Wouldn't he like to get some more information if Zetalot would play something weird?
If you ask like two people what Zetalot plays, you probably get all his deck list beforehand.
I think it depends the sort of type of player you are as well. It really depends on mindset, because he could just... I mean, I'm not sure what else he's got left in his deck, because the deck's must be getting pretty thin at this point, right? But he might just want the extra information if he doesn't have it himself. Or he might just think, you know, this is a super important match. He might just I want to play till I actually lose, because there's always a chance, right?
I mean, he suppose like this deck's no chance. Like, every Hearthstone player would know it, but never mind. Let's just.
Well, you know, it's a big tournament. You don't want to be passive that this player just concedes a match.
I actually think it's strategical to concede and not get yourself fatigued, but.
Zombie Chow is dealing massive damage now. Turns from the reverse Mind Blast into an actual Mind Blast.
Yep.
That is actually insane when it comes
so
to
many
damage.
Zombie Chows this game.
Yep.
Okay.
Nax is out.
Okay, so there's the second Ethereal, but it's really weird. I still don't know what I think about this card. I think playing two, as well as the Drakes, as well as Lotheb in this deck, is too slow for what you want to accomplish. But I've not seen anything yet that really swings the game in terms of spell choice at the moment. I'm sure there are moments like that, but I just don't know if it's consistent enough.
Yeah, of course.
It seems like if you're ahead enough to play this and get super advantage off the spell, then you were pretty ahead anyway.
I think the player was playing it and hoping you get Cone of Cold. Maybe that gives you a remote chance.
We're turning RDU around here. There's now like a tiny chance.
No, like without seeing your opponent's hand, I'm just looking from his perspective. Like seeing Zetalos' hands, there's like no way he loses. Like.
Yeah, but not playing the control here just decreases the effectiveness of this card. Because if there's something that costs more than 5 mana and you would really like to have it,
another turn behind playing it, right?
Let's say Blizzard, Flamestrike.
Yeah, and we've just seen, there's the Blademaster, Deathlord, and... Yeah, I mean, is there even a win condition now? That's my worry. If there's no Antonidas in this deck, like, what's
that? Vaporize!
Oh my god, no one plays around Vaporize with the Death Lord to pull out something to win the game. How far-fetched can we go here, guys?
I mean, we're playing Casino Mage, so...
Yeah, that's true. Although, I've not seen any Spell Slingers.
Yeah, I don't think he can play that in this deck.
When he has Conjurers, he just Conjurers instead of Spellslinger.
In the game.
No, because you don't give your opponent spells. That's the reason why you play Spellslingers over...
The Conjurers
instead of Spellslingers, you know?
Also, those Spellslingers are pretty decent 3 body anyway.
Yeah.
But yeah, this is pretty rough. There's still 2 Light Bombs and Sylvanas left. The Arcane Blast, yes, it kills off the Pyromancer, but at this point, Zetalot actually isn't interested in killing his opponent too fast anyway, so that's just one small minion removed.
Well, that's unfortunately not stealing any creature, but he can go clear, just clear the board, play another Sylvanas. That was 2 fireballs already played this game, right?
Yes.
So there was no way that the Sylvanas gets killed, and it will almost guarantee high value.
That's a good draw.
Yeah.
You can do so many things.
The Alchemist has so many outcomes of what it's going to hit.
Yeah, like you hope you hit it Deathlord three times.
I'll be honest now, Adi, like I am surprised now he hasn't conceded yet, because when you top deck Arcane Missiles and just have to just play it on this board, his only reasoning could be, like you said, Lothar, to just see as many cards as he can. Mm-hmm. But now Zetlot doesn't have to play any cards.
Maybe he has a Deathwing in the deck.
Yeah.
Or third unsavable portal into Deathwing.
Yeah, that can happen. That can happen, right? This is Hearthstone, and it's playing a
Well, actually, well, you laugh at it, but there might be Spellslinger, there's Conjurer. I mean, he used to, but Unstable Portal was a possibility,
a third,
right?
A third portal could have happened. That is true. That is true. Let
me change. The only reason why you would want to continue to play at this point is like hoping your opponent disconnects or something like that. I don't know.
Yeah. But there's no way.
Would you want to regain this? Really? Like, you know, he must hate himself. It's just like, yeah, I'm going to regain this match. And now how that goes.
Now he'll rob the Shredder. never mind.
Rob the Shredder.
Okay, so it's 1-1 between Boz and Zetalot. And Zetalot seals the game with Priest. So we'll have to see the Priest again, which I'm really, really happy to see. Because it's one of the decks that you rarely have the chance to witness in competitive gaming, right? And seeing it being played by a specialist on stream is very entertaining for viewers and for casters.
Yeah, I think that's what I quite like about the format in this tournament specifically. There are no bans, because when we had Last Hero Standing, you know, like previously, mm-hmm. a lot of the bans were aimed at specialist decks. So we didn't get to see, like, for example, Amaz's Priest used to get banned in tournaments, and it's like all everyone wanted was to see Amaz play Priest. So it's kind of good that you get to see these guys bring like their favorite deck and actually be able to play it.
Of course, there's an upside of having a ban in game, because you can just ban Paladin.
Yeah, that's true. Paladin just wouldn't exist in the tournament if that was the case.
Well, there's usually ban Paladin or ban Druid, right?
Yeah,
that's I think it's Warrior or Paladin.
You think it's Warrior? I mean, with
I'm
sure. what
I think it depends on your lineup, right?
Like, I made statistics for Last Hero Standing with a ban and without a ban, and with a ban, you definitely ban Paladin or Warrior. Otherwise, you are vulnerable to too many things. And without a ban, I actually think that you can have lineups like mine, which are like weak to almost nothing on paper, because you have three decks to cover everything, while with a ban, you have four decks to cover almost everything, while they can ban one of yours, so it's harder.
Yeah, it's harder to actually manage it when they can ban whatever. Yeah,
so which one do you favor more, the ban or no ban?
I like both. I just like Last Hero Standing a lot.
Yeah, okay. And they're just different, right? And I think it's okay to actually run multiple different formats in different tournaments. Makes it a bit more interesting and sort of keeps all the players on their toes. But it's going to be Druid versus the Priest, and the Deathlord is almost certainly going to die next turn.
Hopefully.
With the Keeper of the Grove to like really manage it if there's Light of the Narrow. Oh, he does have Powered Shield, actually.
Well, he probably wants to heal it right now.
Healing it is more efficiently, right?
And it buffs the Light Warden to trade for a minion, so that's even more important.
But now he can still double trade and then Keeper the Light Warden.
I just wanted to say that he was thinking, Zetalot was hoping that the Deathlord will pull off a Darnassus Aspirant from the deck.
Yeah.
Not only is the smallest minion in the Druid's deck, it also has a really big downside, a negative.
A battle cry that doesn't exist when it's pulled out of the deck. What are we gonna get?
That's the one of the rare situations when you can actually see the original art of the Druid of the Claw on the board.
Yeah, it's not the worst thing that could have come out, is it? You know, like a 4-4 is still okay. Yeah,
4-4 against Priest?
Yeah,
amazing.
Like, it's still okay. I mean, look, he has Blademaster, though. But, Druid of the Claw is nice when you can actually play it, but for free, it's not too bad.
What would have been the best thing that he would have gotten?
Wargon? No, it dies in Shadow War Death. It might
It's a weird one, Druid, because so many cards have the effects of, like, pick one.
Palette Shredder?
Yeah, probably.
Yeah. Yeah, Shredder probably would have been best.
I think the Darnassus here because they
Belcher? Belcher might have been better.
Yeah, Belcher would have been fine.
Actually, you might know Darnassus. Like, the only reason to play Darnassus would be that he doesn't really have a lot of ways to clear a board, but he can still have Okenai and then circle, at which point you want to follow up with the lore, so you, yeah, you all grow here.
Yeah, because it's guaranteed, right?
But you'd probably trade a 4 to shade, right?
This way you...
Play into Holy Nova for no reason, yeah.
That's weird, but okay.
I don't know. I guess you can do whatever.
If you have I guess growth, you can do that.
You just lore, you're the Savager, and win.
I suppose the only thought I could think of behind it is if the Holy Nova isn't there and the Shade grows once more and draws out a death, then is Ancient of Lore safer? That's the only thing I can piece together at a stretch.
Oh, it's actually better against Vol'jin. Is it?
No, because really. The other one would have been 4-4 anyway, right?
Yeah.
Do you trade here, or just lore face?
I think you definitely play lore first, see what you get.
Yeah, I think lore's too good evaluate. Not to play, and then you just... Yeah, you need to see what you draw first.
You might trade Keeper, because you probably expect the Cabal on 6.
Roots.
Do you play around Cabal here, or do you just go for face?
Well, if he plays Cabal, that's okay for you, right? You still have one minion face, on the board, and your opponent is at 17, so you can deal 5, he'll be at 12, and you have a Savage Force of Nature damage, so that's 7, he'll be at 5, you can go up to 7, you have a swipe, and Living Roots to deal 7. Yeah. That's a kind of setup for lethal, but it's kind of a fetch too.
Yeah, it's a bit of a stretch, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Probably swipe Hero Power Darnassus. Like, there's no really a reason to just taunt up and trade, because Living Cruise doesn't provide you with anything as long as you don't have Savage already, so...
Yeah. Where shall I
strike? Yeah, maybe. Because you saw that he doesn't have the Cabal, so you know your minions are safe anyways. I guess this is a decent line. But is Druid of the Claw better than Belcher? Like, I think you want to play Belcher now, because Druid of the Claw can also charge.
Yes, I always favor that kind of play, because the flexibility of the cards in the Druid decks, this is why Druid is so amazing. You have always versatile use of your minions. And Dr. Bull.
Never lucky.
So how would you want to play around this?
You just boom, full face.
Yeah, I was going to say, there's like boom and the smoke option. Or like, how worried is he about, say, Light Bomb or
like
something?
How can this go badly?
You have already Force of Nature in the hand and Swipe.
Yeah, that's 10
that's
damage.
A
yeah.
lot of damage.
Yeah, and he will be on 10 mana as well. It's not like the losing the crystal doesn't matter at this point. And the fact that he slam boom down pretty much says he's just going to go face, right?
Yeah, of course. I mean, he can still do a trade, but that doesn't have any reason. Okay, now he's not trading. I like this. Like, Boombats are going to hit face, most likely. And in a Light Bomb scenario, they're guaranteed to hit face, I think. Yeah, they are.
So this Aukenai can deal 3 damage with the Light of Naru, but it doesn't really change anything here. He can finish off his Sylvanas with Hero Power.
I don't think there's a way to actually survive this, is there?
Well, I think the best play, what it can do here, is Aukenai, sacrifice Zombie Chow and attack with Sylvanas into the Druid of the Claw, Light of Naru the Darnassus Aspirant, and then Hero Power your Sylvanas for a chance to steal Dr. Boom.
Yeah.
I think you have better chances by playing the Cleric, trying to draw a card, then get Circle, then you play Aukenai Circle, you steal Boom, and then you survive.
Okay.
Yeah, because otherwise, with that play, like, he still dies to the Force and Swipe.
He can actually
play obviously
Naru.
We can see, but...
He can play Naru, too, yeah.
Okay.
But you probably want to play a Naru afterwards. I don't know. Doesn't matter, I guess.
So he still looks for the Circle.
Yep. He's going for the good play.
Nope. And there we go. So Boz is going to take Zathlot's Priest down with his Druid. So he's going to go 2-1 up.
And now, if Zedalot has Tempo Mage, then he's in a pretty bad spot. He has a favorite matchup and a super unfavored matchup. You can still win, though. Like, you can just curve out perfectly versus Paladin and get a good early game.
Good Flamewakers?
Good Flamewakers is one of the ways we win. The other one is, like, good missiles.
Yeah. Anything to just clear off the minions on the
If he has missiles.
And the other way is like just top decking double fireball late game after you like push some damage in the early game.
We'll see what goes on because Zetalot didn't really, I think at least, he didn't really play the mage that much. You know, he usually was winning with the druid or priest.
Yeah.
But seems like Boss has a really good opening hand. Both Wildgrowth and Darnassus and Pathless Shredder allows him to curve into Sludge Belcher, which is amazing.
It's pretty slow.
You mean from mage, right?
From the druid too.
Well, he has Darnassus Aspirant. How it can be any faster?
Because like with innervate, of course. Without innervate,
that?
It's
okay.
Slow, yeah. Because you coin
a druid opening hand is slow unless you have innervate.
Yeah, actually, it's true, but at the same time, you have to be happy that you have the Darnassus Aspirant.
Yeah,
right?
Of course. It's a really good hand, but I said it could be faster.
Yeah.
Double innervate, boom on turn three, I don't know. These kind of things.
Yeah.
It can happen. Like.
Oh, of course, of course.
We saw that many times.
Too many times.
Wildgrowth, trade, play Shredder, play Belcher, play Lotep, play Boom. Probably Druid is favorite here with his hands.
Yeah, it actually looks really amazing for Boss. And in theory, Zetalot's mage should be having an advantage, right, in this matchup.
Well, what do you think that play? So it leaves nothing on the board, and it ramps up into a 5-drop effectively for the druid. Does Zetalot not just play Mirror Entity?
I guess you have to play Mirror Entity.
I think you play Flamewaker. Like he will always play Flamewaker. I think. Because from his point of view, he doesn't know what his opponent has. And even a 4-drop is not like the best thing you can get. You just want to get the Flamewaker threat out there.
Especially now with Frostbolt as well.
Yeah, yeah.
So Shredder comes down and contests the Flamewaker unless there will be an answer to him, which we know that there is. The Frostbolt is just waiting for that. And unstable
portal.
Oh,
that's really nice, actually.
So this can turn the game around, especially if he gets a minion that he can play for 0 mana.
You got one hit.
75%.
Yeah,
so
that's really nice. And
he gets a 6-6 minion, which is also very cool against Druid, especially because he can kill a Druid with the Claw in one swing.
Yeah.
He gets quite reducted if you have more beasts that died, I think.
No, you have to play those when you have... you have to get that card in the hand, with Knight of the Wild, right? And then it goes cheaper whenever you play a beast from your hand.
Yeah. Which everyone thought at first, it was just when
the
card's
deck.
In your deck,
and that would
it
be
gets
amazing.
Cheaper for every beast. That would make Beast Druid a thing, Blizzard.
It would be too powerful, in my opinion.
Yeah, everyone was very upset when when it didn't happen.
I mean, getting a 6-6 for 0 mana is not exactly the most balanced thing.
Okay, so we did see the... did the Lotep come from?
For it to be balanced, by the way, you need to get 5 secrets and to cost 6 mana, not 0. That's
we
the
all love paladins, right?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I mean, we cried about paladins being underpowered like half a year ago. So
yeah.
Now we got what we want for what we wanted.
The grass is always greener on the other side, right?
Yeah.
There will be always one deck that is dominant in the metagame, and nowadays
everyone
it's
will
paladin.
Hate it.
There will be always a part of the community who will be complaining about the best deck in the format, and that's it. It was the same with Patron, but we can kind of agree that Patron was a little bit too overpowered. It was a great design, a great game design, but the power level of the deck was kind of too big.
The actual deck itself was amazing. Like it was actually great. It's just that it was a bit, like you said, it was just a bit like, oh, okay, I was on 30 health, but now I'm dead.
30?
Why do you guys
70?
Talk about Patron in past tense? Like, it's still a thing.
Yeah, I mean,
the burst potential was the problem, wasn't
the burst
it?
Version.
I think Patron is really good right now. I really think it's good.
I'm not disagreeing with you. I'm just saying that the old version was just kind of too powerful.
It was, but it was more inconsistent. Oh. It was more glass cannon than it is right now. Now it's like way more consistent, but can do less things than before.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. But this is really nice here, because like, he's going to presume. I think he knows that's Mirror Entity, because in a... In a, has he played? I can't remember in the previous game. No, he's not sure. That was Bors's mage, wasn't it? So
yes.
I presume it's Mirror Entity at least.
Of course.
And being able to kill off the Lotheb and just give him a 2-4 is really strong.
Especially when you have a 5-3 on board, which can be traded into that.
And then you just drop Shade, right?
Yep. You can... This is also a very interesting thing, because you can leave the Innervate in case your opponent plays a counterspell, right?
Yeah, to just throw, because at this point in the game, yeah, you can.
The Innervate is not that important at this point of the game.
It's
unless
definitely less important than combo,
yes.
Right?
Unless you will have a situation when you can squeeze just an additional minion or a trade with your hero power. So, yeah. Swiperino. I guess you just play Dr. Boom Go Face.
Yep. Sounds like a good plan. And the Druid will probably win this next turn.
Do you reveal the Shade?
Yes, yeah, I think you do, because there's no way that the mage can clear the 1-2 minion
everything
with ease. Right, he would have to use a Frostbolt to do that, or a Flame Cannon that hits exactly that. And you won't risk a Flame Cannon on this kind of order, unless you have to.
Yeah, unless it's literally, well, it's going to be pretty soon, like unless you're literally dead. And you
did he just draw a second one? Yes. Oh,
okay.
Well, that's awkward.
Never lucky.
So that's how much damage? Priest is mage is at 23, 18. And yeah.
Without the bombs hitting.
Oh, okay.
What happens if you hit 4 with every bomb, or if you top deck Savager?
Second swipe, also an option. You can just kill the minion and go phase with the rest.
You might try to bomb first.
Would you? I mean, the minion itself
would you not
is
swipe
just
then bomb.
But you want to play second swipe also, right?
I don't know.
What do you do otherwise? You have...
Just keep it.
Yeah, but you can just finish the game next turn if you play swipe this turn. Because that your opponent will be would have been at 12, right? And then you have 7 damage on board and 6 damage from the hand.
He can still play both next turn, right?
Well, he can, but... It's kind of.
I think the thing is, like, either way, because unless like a Lotheb came down, like either way, if you drew Savage Roar, he wins. If he doesn't, he wins.
Mm-hmm.
So I guess
nice.
It just didn't, yeah, I just guess it just didn't really matter.
And it plays around, Flame Cannon a little bit.
Yeah, that's true.
just a little bit. The Archimedes would have changed, it anyway.
Shredder, heal up our face.
Yeah, just wait. There's no rush at this point. The mage is putting on no pressure. Obviously, we can see Antonidas in there. Okay, missiles is in hand, but he's not in the position where that's actually going to impact the game too much, I don't think.
So if Bors will go for the battle shredder, I'm thinking that it might be legit to play the swipe for the Mad Scientist.
Yeah, you can try to swipe face and then trade with the scientist.
That's of course a better way.
Yeah, especially because on the chance that it is counterspell, like you said earlier, Lothar, that he has the innervate to just throw anyway, so it just shouldn't be a problem. Is there anything that could come out of Shredder that would swing this?
No.
Yeah, 1-1.
Oh wow, oh, really? He's drawing the artillery.
Just Antonidas, arcane missiles, hit it 2 or 3 times.
And
your
then
opponent
one
will get,
one
a, will get
right.
A free attack or 2-attack minion and he'll win.
This will be hilarious if that actually happens.
All face. Oh.
Okay.
But it actually kills it. So if it's a Vital Totem, or Lightwell, or a... That's six, that's lethal.
Okay.
Unless... No, it's lethal. Always.
I need to start with Innervate in case he's counterspell.
Of course.
Yep.
Actually, you start with Wild
Growth. And it's counterspell! Look at that!
Yeah. I mean, he did have Wild Growth as well.
Yeah, but, you know, the Innervate.
But but Lothar was right. He did Innervate to break this counterspell.
So, Bosch has taken 3-2-1, the top 16 round, kicking out Zetalot in the last match before getting points and cash prize. Feels bad, man, but that's how it is in Hearthstone world. The world is grim and dark. There's no future. I mean, of course, we're... Just joking here, but for Bors, it is a happy moment.
You had to just like, I was joking, by the way. I don't really think this about life.
Yeah, it's a happy moment for Bors. This is his first international event, and he's already in the top 8. So a memorable moment already.
Yeah, like you said, I mean, there's multiple facets to it. There's the obviously the money now is mm-hmm. is in the bank. The BlizzCon points, you know, to some respect are there, and even and I think probably like most importantly, at least a top eight finish. Yeah. At DreamHack, that's a really strong achievement.
Mm-hmm. Also, from other news, Greenship won 3-1 against Syntex.
Oh, okay.
So, I think we were having Borsch back on our seat, and he's coming right back to us. Come on, take your place. Welcome, Borsch. How are we doing?
Hi, guys. Well, it feels great.
Of course, and I felt that you were a little upset in the first game when the crash happened, right? But you were having a good matchup, so it turns out it didn't matter, yeah. Right?
So right. I mean, the second draw was really great in the rematch, so I can't complain.
Yeah, of course. But you had like a already a good presence on the board in that game too, when you could have just played Mad Scientist into RevGuard, right? And that was just huge board for the Druid to deal with. But what do you think about the match in general? What were just like a moment that you had like a doubt that you will not take it, or any kind of moments like that?
I was quite confident after I defeated the priest,
mm-hmm.
But because I know that Zitalot is a great priest player, and I knew with the matchup was quite bad. And I really didn't feel well playing with the mage against the priest. And I thought the matchup with the druid was fine overall. I didn't want to face the priest with my paladin deck.
Okay, another question. Can you explain why are you playing two Azure Dragons and two Conjurers at the same time and a Lotep in your deck?
That's a lot of five drops.
That's a lot of five drops. But I cut Antonidas and Emperor, so five is the top of my curve.
Okay, makes sense.
Yeah, because in the mage versus priest game, because it went on for so long and it did look
pretty. Yeah, would have helped.
It looked pretty grim for you for a long time, and I was actually trying to wonder: were you like waiting to draw something like rag or you know like just something big to actually hit the board? I did thought like maybe you did have Antonidas to actually have a chance at pushing it through the damage, because that's what was so secure for a massive chunk of that game.
Yeah, because the Conjurer is really great, much better than I initially thought, because mm-hmm. it really helps if you can get a mage spell in your hand after you know what your opponent is playing.
Okay.
So you sometimes can get a spell you wouldn't have included in your deck list originally, but then it can really be awesome, like Flamestrike.
Yeah, it's the way Discover's been working out in general, isn't it? It's very reactive, and you can make a judgment call based on what's happening at that moment. It's not like if you see Frostbolt, you should always take Frostbolt, because Frostbolt's a fantastic card, but sometimes it's like, well, no, maybe like Arcane Missiles is better and stuff like that.
But
so
it's cool to see a different approach into the Temple Mage, just cutting the end game and making it like more aggressive, I would say, right? By playing the Conjurer.
With more draw, you can cut the curve a little bit, because normally you get enough cards so you don't run out of steam.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Okay. Makes sense. Congrats for having, you know, already the top eight under your belt.
Thank you.
First international event. And we both were having an experience in card games and in analog one. This is like the trademark, right? Top eight of an event is something you strive to be in, and it's already an achievement by itself.
Feels awesome.
Yeah.
So, but it's still, you can play and win the whole event, and of course, that's the goal. Another goal,
that's
right?
The goal for tomorrow.
Yes. So, good luck tomorrow, and we'll be having Greenship for an interview now. So, thank you again, boss, and see you tomorrow.
Yeah. Same.
We'll be having Greenship for a second here. Come on, Greenship. I can't really do the accent like Froden does, but so I will not.
British accent that Froden does.
Hi, Grinch, what are you doing, man? Can you tell us something about your match?
About my match? I won 3-1, so mm-hmm. I started with Secrets Paladin. I won two games with that. I beat his Patron Warrior, which was like the important matchup, because his Patron could 3-0 me, but I think that's the only deck that could beat my lineup. So mm-hmm. I beat that deck, and that was a pretty important match. And I won the next game, Secret Paladin, against, I think it was, let me think. I can't remember.
You won with Secret Paladin,
I won with Secret Paladin
that's
twice.
That's the story.
Then
here,
I lost the Secret Paladin mirror, but I beat.
That's so funny. I was just about to say, like, so what beat you, Secret Paladin?
Yeah,
Paladin,
Secret
of
Paladin.
Course.
Okay, and what was the last game?
Tempo Mage. Okay. I played Tempo Mage and beat Secret Paladin.
Okay. Do you think Secret Paladin is the best deck at the moment?
I've done pretty well, and I think Hoi's like 18-0 with that deck, so it's pretty good.
That is really insane, right? So you already are in the top 8, and you have to be happy, right?
Yeah, I'm pretty happy, and I think I'm playing Boars next, because it was Boars versus Zetalot, and I'm pretty happy about that, because Zetalot had Priest, and Priest just 3-0s my lineup straight off.
Okay, that's very good for you then. You also know exactly what kind of deck Boss plays now, so you can also plan accordingly, right? So it seems that you'll be going confident.
I'm pretty happy with my position right now.
Okay, good. So we'll be seeing you tomorrow, because we will broadcast all the games tomorrow during the broadcast of the final day. It will be 7 matches, and we'll be going into a short break before we'll be seeing another match from the top 16. So don't go anywhere, guys. This is DreamHack Winter Grand Prix.